verse 2 of chapter 1. We are ready to do exciting things. We're halfway through the course.
Kind of fast, aren't you?
Yeah. We decided we were going to call this Johannian verse. But we can't do that anymore because we're sitting in verse 2 now. Well, we can't call it the satanic verse.
Oh, no.
Okay. Verse 2, the same was in the beginning with God. Are there any new words in there? The same. Ah, well, I guess we better examine the same. Okay, the same. Most of us are familiar with the scripture in Hebrews chapter 13, I think it's verse 8. It says, Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. Right? Most of you know that. Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. And while that verse really is not bringing out the unchangeableness of God, I think the original Greek actually reads, Jesus is the Christ, the same Christ, yesterday, today, and forever. We use it to bring out the unchangeableness of God, and there are many other verses, there are many scriptures that bring out the unchangeableness of God. I don't know that that's the best one, according to the Greek, to bring that out, but we can use that. And even if the truth is still the same, even if the scripture actually doesn't bear out what we're trying to bring out in that particular verse. So we want to start with the ground that you understand that God is unchanging. But you're not going to get very far with that truth when you start it. In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God. You're not going to get very far seeing that He's unchangeable in relationship to what? You understand what I mean? Nothing has been created yet. So there must be a deeper concept than just the unchangeableness of God. So there is this understanding that God is unchangeable, that He is stable, that He is, as we quote it, the same yesterday, today, forever, that there is this consistency with God. And so we will say, the same was in the beginning with God, and we will say, He is the same. He is consistent. He is always, if you understand the attributes that, if you will, you need from God, and that God is consistent, then that should bring comfort to you, that should bring security to you, should bring a lot of other things. Okay? I want to introduce this, though, not just as an attribute of God, the same. Not just as an attribute. That's what you've always heard. That's what you've held to when you've seen this term, the same. I want to bring this word out, the same, as a title for Jesus, or a name for who Jesus is, what He is like. Not just in terms of His consistency, but that Jesus is the same. That Jesus is the same. The Lord showed me this years and years and years and years ago. When He showed it to me, man, it really changed so much in my scripture searching. Because I had been taught up to that point to think in terms, when I saw this reference, the same, when I saw it throughout the Bible, to think in terms of His consistency of God, His consistency of God, is something that was an attribute that kind of came out from Him. And the Holy Spirit began to teach me Christ as the same. Christ as the same. This is going to take the Holy Spirit for you to see this. But if you begin to see it, it's going to change the way you read your Bible.
Say, sets forth an attribute of the character, but a name of who he is.
I said a title. So when you read in your Bible, when you read the same, it shouldn't remind you of consistency or unchangeableness on God's part, but should testify to Christ. Once again, I realize I'm introducing some things in a different way, but I'm trying to get you to begin to open yourself to the Holy Spirit, even right now. You know, you don't even have to wait until later on for all this to soak in. The Holy Spirit is going to teach you right now. It's not talking about having a consistent mind, but doesn't it talk about having the same mind? It's not talking about having a consistent mind. It's not talking about having an unchanging mind. And if that's the way that we've always read that, then we have put it on the ground of us instead of the ground of it being the person of Christ. We need to see Jesus. And according to verse 1 and 2, there ain't nothing there but Jesus the Father and the Holy Spirit. So there, I don't know what else you're going to see. The Word isn't the Scriptures at this point. The Word is the Son. And the same is the Son. It is not an attribute of Him. It is not something He brings to you. It is the Son. So, it's not speaking of having a consistent terminology of words or always speaking the same words. Remember, the Scriptures that speak the same thing. So what would we do? We would read that Scripture. We would seek to be consistent in our terminology or our words. But it's not talking about you changing or putting in concrete so that it doesn't change. It's not talking about you at all. And the only way that you can fulfill those Scriptures is know Christ as the same. That's the only way that you can fulfill. In fact, you cannot fulfill the Scripture. We talked about this last time. You can keep the Scripture. Only Christ can fulfill the Scripture. And the way that He will be able to do that for you and you and you and you and you and you is because He is the same. So when you read that, don't look to you. Look to the same. See what I'm saying? But we always look, we immediately start with us. And we have not seen the same was in the beginning with God. The same was there. The same before our mind had the same mind, had the same words. The same before our mind or before our words or anything else should tell you that if it uses this term the same, that it is out of your hands as concerning law, you perform it, legally perform it. It is out of your hands. If it uses this term the same, it is out of your hands as concerning law and something for you to fulfill. And it is something Jesus must become in the Spirit. It is something that Jesus must. So if it says, having the same mind, so what do? You say, well, okay, how does the preacher put this? And I'll join in with that. No. Speaking the same words. So you say, you parrot everything that I say or what God says or whatever. And you missed it because you have put it in the form of something in your hands through the legal means that you're going to perform. But you have not sought by the Spirit to see Jesus, who is the same. He is the same. So if it says having the same mind, you've got to immediately look to Jesus. Because the same is in the beginning with God. Not you, not words, not minds, not anything.
The wrong way would be if we had the same, that would be two and not one.
Right. Right. That wouldn't be the same, would it? There would be a copy. There would be a Xerox copy of the original. it's not. Now, there, it's got to be the original. It's not the same original. Is that right? It is not the same. It is a copy of the same, but it's not the same. So now, that's a good question. That's a good way to put it. Because now, through that, you're beginning to enter into another viewpoint from God's viewpoint of His Word. I mean, this is His Word. In the beginning was the Word, the same. And when you begin to see from His viewpoint, instead of everything every preacher's ever taught you, or everything every man or finite being can teach you, will come down to this realm, made practical, and let me get hold of this baby, instead of being brought up, and we talked about upward motivated, being brought up, raised up, set in another realm, and beginning to see, you know, I mean, not just see this from that, but see this, the Word of God from a whole other, from His mind. He, you know, that's what we've got to do. That's what we, you know, never understand the Scriptures. You know, the Pharisee says, well, we've, God kept the Scripture, I've done this, I've been good, I've been it, you know what I mean? And he's going to say, I never knew. But you didn't understand the Spirit. You set about to get the letter, to figure out the letter. Lord, what would you have us to do? Instead of saying, Lord, let Christ be formed in you. That Christ may be all in you. That Christ may be all and in all. All right, so it is true that God is changeless. That we understand that. But that there's something greater, and that is the fact that Jesus is the same. When it says in the Bible, the same, it is a reference to Christ. Okay, so the same was in the beginning with God. The same is what a world that is later to be created, that is going to have chaos brought in by the enemy, that is going to have upheavals, and it's going to have emotional highs and lows, and circumstantial upheavals, and then times of tranquility, and all of what we understand to be life is going to be filled with things that are going to keep us off balance and everything. But before all that came into existence, God established the same. The same was in the beginning of God. Now, it is our responsibility to understand what He means by that. And to seek Him, then you can't even understand. You don't know. If you don't think the Lord, oh, this means I've got to figure out God. No. This means you have to go to God. Because you can't figure out God. Only God can explain God. And that's why He said, I have not seen, ear has not heard, neither is there in the heart of man that thinks that God has prepared for them that love Him. But God has revealed them unto us by His Spirit, even the things that are freely given unto us of God. So He voids out, He takes man at his sense realm realities. He takes man and He says, I have not seen there, has not heard either, is entered into the heart of man. And He says, what I don't know if you ever thought of this, but Scripture that led into that is that had the God of this world known what was going to happen on the cross, He would not have crucified the Lord of glory. But He saw Jesus doing miracles, and He said, let's kill Him and get Him out of here. So Jesus cast out devils, said, let's get Him, and more demons will be cast out. You know, He saw, He felt, He heard, and He says, if we can kill Jesus, this will be the answer. That's His central. And had the God of this world known what was going to be the result, He would not have crucified the Lord of glory. Then He speaks to us, and He says, I have not seen, ear hath not heard, neither has it entered into the heart of man the things that God has prepared for them that love Him. But, and He says, for what man knoweth the things of man except the spirit of man? And what man, you know, you don't know. I mean, you can, somebody can sit there and go, I love you. And on the inside, you go, well, I'm just waiting for my chance to kill or do something. You know what I mean? You don't know. You know, I've been really, well, I've had counseling sessions where someone said, well, I think that's the real good. You're going to find out. Misinterpreted everything I said. You know, they're leaving God and the church. sent to reveal these things that are, and I like the way that it's put, freely given of us, given to us of God. So there's no way that you're going to search out God. You ain't smart enough, you don't have enough room. So instead of searching out God, what I do is I search out the Holy Spirit, meaning I search him down. Go, hey, I need to talk with you. Because he knows everything. And Jesus is the one who told me, one of the disciples walking with him, I must go away. I'm going to send the Holy Spirit, and he's going to teach you all things. He'll guide you in all truth, and he'll tell you things concerning me. So he's the one I want to stick closest to, the Holy Spirit. And how do I know I'm close with the Holy Spirit? When I go to the Scriptures and see his word. Because he's not going to speak of himself. Jesus said, the Spirit are like the wind. And you see the wind. No, you can't see the wind. How do you know the wind is there? How do I know the wind's blowing right now? I can see its movements. Okay? How does the wind blow? It blows through a chicken. How does the Spirit blow? He blows through and reveals Christ. That's how I know if the Spirit is with me. Now, you say, well, what about, you know, if you're sitting in church and all of a sudden you see somebody and they start going, hum, 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 hum. Is that the Spirit? Could be. No. The one thing I know, you cannot see Jesus apart from the Holy Spirit. And that's something you can't fake, and I've heard people try to fake it. It's sounding brass and tinkling cymbals. Somebody has actually spent time with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit begins to speak of the Lord. Christ begins to be lifted up. Not them. There's no, it's not like, oh man, I'm really great, or man, you wouldn't believe what the Lord showed me, that we're really sons of God. But they'll begin to say, man, God is my Father. It's different, isn't it? God is my Father. His Father. I'm a son of God by Christ. Then you know. Then you see the, you know, the movements of the Spirit coming. So, how are you going to know this was, which was before the creation of all things, this one who is called the saint that was there at the beginning of God? He's also called the Word, but that is another way of knowing this, shall we call him this one? Because how do you slap labels on him? You can't. These are labels long before there was a creation, then man, then a fall, then sin, then Redeemer. These are terms, these are eternal terms. This is eternal reality that we're trying to move into, and you're not going to do that. You ain't going to stumble in there, you ain't going to be walking on, whoa, you know, I mean, you don't just stumble in there. You have to be brought in. And there's only one way. When the heart turns to the Lord, not the mind, not the emotions, not bad circumstances. But when the heart turns to the Lord and says, God, I want you above everything, above reputation, above this and that, above everything, I want you. The Spirit of God will not cast his pearl before swine. But if you truly want the Lord, the Spirit of God is faithful. He wants you to know Jesus more than you want to know Jesus. He, every day, is down here with us. He is up in heaven. He's down here. Now, I don't know if that means anything to you, but I don't think that would be pretty good. Because he's called the Holy Spirit. But he's down here with one purpose, and that is to lift up Christ. Not just Christ the Savior. That which is from the beginning. So, that's why I say, you're not going to know the same. You're long mimic the same. You become a Xerox copy of it. Then you say, well, see, it's the same. You hold up your Xerox copy and say, see, it's the same. And it's like holding up a picture of Jesus, and the Father would be holding his Son and saying, no, it's not the same. You understand what picture of Jesus going, oh, I just love you, Jesus, and you know, that ain't the same. But it looks so similar. And in the last days, many people are going to be deceived. You know why? Because the similarities, the Bible talks and it says that the false prophet of the Antichrist is going to work miracles, and by reason of those miracles, people are going to run after him. Well, you've got to be of God because you do these miracles. That's what they said of Jesus. That's what Nicodemus, one of the top religious leaders of the day, came and said, good master, we know that you are Son of God because you know man could have done such miracles. And Jesus said, you must be born again. What is born again? To receive the seed. The same seed that everybody else receives. Nobody gets a carbon copy. There are no grandchildren in the kingdom of God. Everybody receives the original seed, Christ. Everybody gets that same Jesus. And so, you know, Jesus looked at Nicodemus and said, forget that. He didn't even say forget that. He didn't argue about miracles or not miracles, because he certainly worked them. But he didn't argue on that point. He didn't get off on that. He said, look, there's just one need right here. You must receive the original seed, the same. And then we can talk, because then we can have the same mind, the same spirit, the same reality. But as long as you're not, you've got your little picture of what you think it is, and I have the original, then all we can do is talk around the subject, and, you know. And let me tell you, there is no fellowship. There is no fellowship in having someone that you love dearly and hugging them, and they're over there with a picture, and they can't even seem to see the one, but they think that they're fellowshipping with you in this one, that they're not fellowshipping. They're fellowshipping on the basis of the picture that they've had painted for them. But when they know him, you will have fellowship. And with fellowship, there is, I will put it like this, there is feasting. With fellowship, there is feasting. There is a mutual feeding and feasting on the Lord. When there is no fellowship, you might talk about the same thing, but it's not the same. But you think it, you know, a person thinks it's the same, but it's not the same. It's not the same. You understand what I mean? It's not the same. It's similar, but it's not the same. And it didn't say it. The similar was in the beginning of God. The same is in the beginning of God. Similar, it like horseshoes, closest, good. Similar is just as far as not even close. It must be the same. It's a law. It's a law of God. It is the way it is. It's going to be, because he is the same yesterday. He is the Alpha and Omega. God didn't say, we'll start with you at the beginning and in the end. It's going to be really good because you started this. No. It's going to be really the same. Just more of. Now it was Christ here. Now it's Christ is all, and now is in all. The same. And so all of our little denominations, and all of our little churches, and all of our little Sunday school lessons, and all of our little church sermons, and all of our little things can be similar. They can be very good. They can be helpful as to how to deal in the sense realm with a contentious spouse, or a nice little object lesson on, but is it the same as what God wants to teach? And the answer in many cases is, it's not even close. It isn't even close. It is not Christ. But see, if I say Christ, we always think of Jesus of Nazareth and Canaan. This is before Jesus of Nazareth. We're not talking about Jesus of Nazareth. We're talking about the same. He will be in the, and let me God on this subject. He is, Jesus to him is going to be the same. He is not going to lessen his viewpoint and go, you know, Jesus is really, really wonderful, but you know, you're an awful cute little saint there, an awful little sweetie, you know what I mean? He ain't done that, ain't going to happen. He's giving you the same, and that's what it's all about. Any trying to be something apart from receive something, to as many as received him, jump ahead. To as many as received him, the same. They're the sons of God, didn't say. To as many as really started acting like the Father and looking like him, and you know, the Father walks this way or does this and copies the Father, they are the sons of God, didn't say that. To as many as received him, that's it. You've got all that comes with that because you've got the same as that. Jesus said, if Father, let them know that you've loved them as you've loved me, but of course, we are one. Now, his whole prayer is that we may be one. And yes, we're one. The same. Was anybody able to follow me? Let me tell you, when I saw this, I thought, how in the world am I ever going to explain? Remember when I saw this in there? Yeah. And there was for sure one man that saw it too. I saw him at a conference about 8 years later, and he was teaching. He said, yeah, a good friend of mine shared this truth. He was talking about the same. He said, it changed his life. So his truth has really affected me. And what it does is it just, all of a sudden, it just makes... It's like Greg and I were talking before class today. When you begin to see God's reality, it doesn't put more burden on you. It doesn't weigh you down. It doesn't make it harder. It makes it easier. Because all things, you know, I always see it like this, and in one sense, I'm jumping ahead to the next verse. But it's like this concept of the one who sees the same, the Word, and then all things being flung out in the universe, all people, all things, you know, but then it all will eventually come back and be gathered together in one. Brought back down to the basic reality instead of a million, you know, we jump in the middle of this and try to figure out how this intertwines with this, and what is the, you know what I mean, how many of these have to make up just this, and, you know, and it's too complicated. It shows the profundity of the one, meaning when broken down to as many ways as you can, it's profound. And yet, God said this, or the Holy Spirit said this, be not removed from the simplicity that is in Christ. We make it hard. God doesn't make it hard. You say, I don't really understand what you're saying, Randy, so it must be hard. It's not hard. It's really no different than anything I've told you, especially in this class. It's nothing new that I've said yet. I just use a different name for the same thing. It is the same. God, nothing else is going to ever, ever, ever matter. How good you were today, or yesterday, or how bad, or how much you've given to God, or how much you have tried. The only thing ultimately that's going to matter is, have you received the seed? Right. And if you have received the seed, then you now have in your possession all. And you should learn to be satisfied with that and grow in the knowledge of the one who is all. Instead of receiving the all and then going out and ignoring the all and trying to be the all or produce from the only the all was the one. Can't produce. Who is the same? Who is the Lord?
Yeah, I keep saying how, you know, I mentioned it before, how how we have our own concepts of everything and the way that we word things, those are concepts back to different things. There's always a separation by our concepts. I was talking with Lisa, sharing with her that my concept was, I'm over here and Christ is over there, so we have two different things. Then I said, no, but I learned that I'm not over here and Christ is over here. I'm over here with Christ, and I put myself like this. But even that's two separate things.
Right.
With an understanding that it's no longer I'm over here, it's Christ, which is one. And so it's just having concepts of learning what that one is and who that one is all about.
That's what let me try to draw it like this. Let's forget and just let me kind of take away all of this. I don't want to redraw it all. I'm going to take us back to the beginning. God's beginning. Not the beginning of creation. God's beginning. What God called the beginning. In the beginning was the Word. The Word. This is another term that we find later. He's called the Son. But in this early stage, he is the complete, he's the Logos. That's so let's take Son out because Son hasn't been mentioned. He is the Logos. He is the complete thought and concept of God at this stage. There is nothing else. The Father has deemed him such. The Father has said, declared it to be. And where is that concept declared to be? Where is this instituted? In the beginning, okay? At what location? Okay, so in the beginning God created the heaven and the earth, so we're talking actually before the beginning, which was the creation beginning. So there must, if he is all, he is the total thought concept, where is that?
It's hard to think of, I'm trying to think of it in terms of the beginning before creation. It's hard to think in terms
of... We'll dig into that when we get to verse 3 more clearly.
But that general direction, that beginning was the eternal beginning.
Yes. How?
Is the beginning not a time, but a state of being?
It's a state of being.
Place.
Yeah, and what I'm trying to get at is, where is that place?
In Christ.
Okay. Yes. No. Before something. Isn't it funny how we keep having to refer to this that hasn't come into existence yet? No. It's in the heart of the Father. So when the Bible says the Word, which is the same, unchangeable, the same, is in the beginning with. Remember with. Now think of the way we explain with, and you will understand. It is with the Father, or in the heart of the Father. Okay. Now, this is important, because we view everything based on religion, or us, or where we're at, or time and space, and all this kind of stuff. Jesus is the same, unchangeable as far as who he will always be, the total thought and concept of God. He will be the same. Once God creates all this and flung out, made by him and for him and to him and from him, this one, all this stuff comes in the heart of the Father. None of these factors, this creation, this universe, these people, these circumstances, wars, this bad hair day, none of this stuff affects the Father at all. Why? Because the same is there in his heart. Unchanged will Christ always be the complete thought concept of God, the Logos, the Word. Therefore, the same. Nothing you can do. So anything that you can do in time and space cannot, you know, Jesus said this, is, you know, why do you go about trying to do this and that? Why do you take off for the day? Which, let's put this little gap right here, which is way too big. This is like really 100 years. I couldn't draw on this one. And you put it in there, and he says, why do you, by taking thought for today, do you think you can add one cubit to his stature?
No.
No. so much liberty, we want to fire, release you. It don't matter what you do. The only thing that really matters is if your heart comes to the Lord, God is going to reveal His thought, His concept, and your life will be forever changed. And everything you do on your little linear thing, well, you know, Abel caught just a little bit of sight of this thing. And his blood was shed because he was the son after the image of this one right here. He was, you know, there, I don't know if you've ever studied this, but there is a line that runs through Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, and there is Cain, there's always the wicked side, and there is the Abel, always the after the image of Christ one. That's the only thing that gives them the glory. It's not them, it is that they begin to, and Abel's blood yet speaking way down here. Why? Is his blood special in anybody else's? No, it is a picture of this son that died and was shed his blood and was innocent blood and he didn't do anything. And it is a picture of this other woman who is shortcut people called Satan, who attacks thinking that had he understood, he would not have killed the son of the Lord, but nonetheless he'll throw Joseph into prison. He'll try to kill everybody that he thinks has the seed he wants to destroy, thinking that he doesn't understand. He sits around. You know, all I know is we got to get rid of him. And he doesn't realize that there's this spiritual reality that runs above all of this, that the Son is the same all along the line, in Abel, in Moses, in, Joseph, and anywhere along the line, he is the same, and he is Alpha, and he is Omega, and he is all the letters in between. He is that in you. But it's not just a consistency that we're talking about. It is this one who is all to the Father. He is the complete thought concept. At the end, he says that Christ will be all and in all. Some are going to stand before God and go, okay, here's my testimony of how good I did in my linear time. I cast out demons and I did this and I did that. And the Father's going to say, depart from me. I never knew you. Has anybody here ever looked at those scriptures and go, my God, they did more than we did. They're casting out demons. They're doing all this stuff. You know, what chance do I have? He didn't say, You didn't do enough, therefore depart from me. He said, I didn't know you. Do you know what? Here we go, hard belief. He only knows the Son and those who are. Hard belief. Hard for anybody who is going out to carve out their little niche for God. Easy for those who either by the grace of God somehow saw the same and said, hey, he's the same in all these people's lives. I have seen nothing but Jesus, not you. It's funny, you look at Hebrews chapter 11 there, isn't it, where he talks about faith? Yeah, Hebrews 11, and he says, and by faith so-and-so did this, and by faith so-and-so did this and everything. And so, you know, and we look at, and so we're going, oh, these are examples that we should live according to. But if you look at the examples, they were all pictures of Christ. It wasn't that these were held up as great men that you should copy. These men all learned Christ in a certain way, and it manifested at a certain time, and God isolated that spot in their life and put it in mind and made a big deal out of that, you know. And so, we call that their history. You know, let me tell you, Abraham probably cussed and did a bunch of other stuff at different times. No, I have a lot of that stuff, but it has a time when the father, Abraham, brought his son and laid him on the altar and was willing to, you know, and that's a picture of the heavenly Father giving his son. It wasn't just a good work. It was the same, over and over and over. It's the same. Everything must be the same. You understand? Different circumstances, different things, but the same comes out of it every time. Every time. So, that, you know, I mean, you look at somebody like Samson, terrible life, horrible life, and yet in the very end he looks and he goes, man, you know, I'm blind, I've done this, I've done this, but I tell you what, I will give myself and bring down the enemy here, and he didn't commit suicide, he laid down his life. And it says this. This is how you know it was the same at work. The same. That in his death, he did more than in his life. That's a big, that was the same. Jesus, Samson is held up in Hebrews 11 as an example. Well, what are we going to follow in his life? I mean, at best, you know, push a building over and die? Or at worst, live the way he did? No. You know what the only good, decent, halfway anything about him was? The original, the same, manifested at a certain juncture of time. And I said, there he is. That's all I wanted. You're in him. That's it. Right there. That's it. We go. Yeah, I don't understand that. So then he goes all the way through Hebrews 11. And then he starts Hebrews 12. And he says, these all that. And he says, and so here's what we should do. And he says, looking unto Jesus. Oh man, we're just going to have to look at that. You're just going to have to look at that. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1. So in chapter 11, it talks about all these people and all the stuff they did and all the great things. But let me tell you something. In no case is it talking about all these people, all the great works they did. This isn't what Hebrews 11 is talking about. Hebrews 11 is describing the same as he manifested and by their faith was able to manifest in their lives. Okay? So then chapter 12 begins, wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin that does so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus. Didn't say, look at these men, learn how they live, and you live a good one too, buddy. You know, I didn't say that. Didn't say that. It says, let's look unto Jesus because he authored the faith in their heart, and he was the manifestation of anything that is held up. I promise you he is, because the Father, the same, he is only the same, not anywhere else in the beginning, except in the heart of the Father. That will not change. It will never change. It will never change. And when you get that figured out, it makes life easy, not hard. Because then you go, hey, you know, there's only one thing that the Father's after. That's his Son. His Son is in me. And so now it's a process not of figuring out what good things I can do to please God. Learning this Christ, yielding, let this mind, not do this mind, let this mind be in you, which is also in Christ. Really, this whole chapter moves on in, it gets into chapter 13 there, where it talks about Jesus being the same yesterday, today, and forever. Okay, so let me read a little bit. Though our circumstances change and dispensations come and go, kingdoms come and go, nations come and go, yet he is the same. Once again, don't say, yes, he's the same towards us. That's not what we're talking about. That would be an attribute. Don't keep falling back to the thing that you've learned all your life about him being the same. He is the same in the heart of the Father. Therefore, he is all that God is at. Unstable minds are so because they don't know Jesus that he's the same. Unstable minds. Unstable minds are so because they don't know Jesus who is the same. Would that make sense? If you really could understand it the way I'm saying it, it would make sense. Because if this is the same, this is carried through all the way unstable would simply move in a sense around and would view things based on you. But if the same is the same, the heart of the Father, and you perceive that, then it, you know, you, okay, you blew it today. Get up, take advantage of the blood, take advantage, don't make void the grace of God by going, oh, how can I go to Jesus again? I ask, how can you not? You know what I mean? And now you can talk about the consistency. The consistency is the blood is there, the consistency is all those things are there. But it's not enough to go to the stability of the blood all the way through, and you can receive that at any joint, at any point to a new beginning. The consistency is not enough. That Jesus died on the cross and you're dead all the way through, and da da da. The consistency has got to be that the Son is the same to the Father, and by faith I am in the Son, and therefore all that ever needed to be done has been done, and that's settled. Now that's not just something being the same that you grab hold of in a sense, and this is what I think many people in this church and in this Bible school have done, is that it has been their little life down here, and they jump up and grab hold of this from time to time when they need it, when they get shook. Folks, it ain't that way. You're in the Son. The thing that remains the same is that Jesus is the same to the Father, and that you're in the Son. Period. You're in Jesus. And you are not known until He appears. When He appears, you'll be like Him. But the only reason why you'll be like Him is you'll see Him as He is, not see Him transform before you and go to do yourself. You know, you will see the truth that has always been the truth, and it is the same all the way through. But here's the neat thing. Here's the reality, folks. Forget all the way through, because God didn't do it that way. Here's the beginning. Here's the way it is. That's the way it is. Get all the way through means nothing. This is it. This is the reality. And you're in there. But that's not the way we live. We keep going back to it. We keep, you know, trying to find the consistency of the truth in our lives and apply it. We're not in the Son. We visit the Son. You know what I mean? We're not hid in Christ. We're very much blatantly seen in the world. You know? This is our existence, but there is a consistency that I believe, so my faith, though it's not really as consistent as it ought to be, I consistently go back to that truth when I get in trouble. And there is this consistency that I am in Christ. And when I really see that I've gotten off from that truth, I can go back because there's this consistency with God. It ain't consistency with God that counts. It is the same. The same. You have not found Him as the same. You have found that He will do the same thing for you. He will reconfirm that you are in Christ. Get you on your feet. Make you feel better about follow the Lord and everything, give you a new beginning, and you will proceed back into here and apply that truth as best as you can in your circumstance. When in reality, you're not here. You know what? This is really wild. You are in Him, and He is in you. Where are you? In you? No, you're in Him. He is in you. Jesus said, we'll get into it, we will get into that very shortly, John 15. Jesus said, I am the vine, you are the branch. Abide in me, and I in you, and you shall bear fruit. That's what he said. Abide in me, and I in you, and you'll bear fruit. So what do we do? We don't abide in Him. We don't let Him abide in us. We try to be good and do the things we're supposed to, and we don't bear fruit, and then we go, ooh, I don't know why I'm not bearing fruit. What's wrong with you? I'm still with you, Lord. You're with. I'm with you. He says, if you're with me, you do it my way. Let my words abide in you, and my words are what? Abide in me. You know. I'm here. I'm remain the same. Jesus is stable in the heart of the Father. There is no chance that Jesus is going to fall out of favor with the Father. I'm in that water. Therefore, my relationship is solid, solid, solid. Okay. Now, this is something Greg and I were talking about. Said, you know, if you trust that, then guess what? You again begin to be transformed into the image of Christ. In other words, Christ will begin to be formed in you because you're being solid in Him. His life begins to be formed in you. And you don't run off going, well, I'm glad I'm solid in the Son and it'll never change in the heart of the Father, so I can do anything I want. The truth is, you can do anything you want, but if you really abide, you'll eventually end up doing what He wants because that's what a Son does. Jesus put it this way, I do always those things that please the Father. Well, that wasn't a testimony of how good He's been that week. That certainly wasn't. That's a testimony of the same as understood by the heart of the Father. He does. And the more you conform to Him, the more you will, but you will never conform to Him. You know, here's the thing. You know how we think we're going to conform to Him? We think we're going to get it by coming to classes and by, when we know something is bad, not do the bad thing, but do the good thing. Which, once again, could be the wrong truth, couldn't you? But the right way to approach it is to never, ever leave this spot. Don't even get out of the church. Just that this is where I am. You know, Mallory and I were talking about that today. I remember God revealed this to me. And I was in Bible school, so I graduated from Bible school, and I was sent immediately to the mission field, spent 2 years on the mission field. And here on the mission field, I'm a missionary, and God is teaching me that I'm in Christ. It don't matter what I do. It don't matter what I say. If I work, if I don't work, if I give my life, if I don't give my life. I'm in Christ. That's all. It's so overwhelming. And I stayed there. I didn't try to figure out, you know, how to let Christ come through me or anything. I just abode in Christ. I said, this is it. And I believed it. And I held that position and everything. And a brother was talking to me because, you know, things would get shook. And I would get shook because I'm in Christ. So he was, you know, this guy was over me, actually, there. And I was fixing a door frame or something. It had come loose or whatever. And I was laughing as I was telling him that it didn't matter what I did. And the reason why I'm a missionary and the reason why I'm fixing this door frame right now is that I cannot gain any more stature than the fullness of God anyway. Jesus is all that God ever wanted. How is me tacking up a little door thing falling down going to make me any better in God's sight today? I am in His Son. That's all that matters. And why am I doing this? I laughed. I said, why does God even have me on the mission field? I mean, I could sit down in a bar for the next 2 years if I really felt like it. And I'm in the Son, and it doesn't matter. So, but then I said, but because I am in the Son is in me. And I find myself seeing that broken down, and I don't go, well, you know, somebody will fix that or whatever, you know. I mean, I wouldn't want somebody to fix it if I could fix it. You know, because I'd like for it to be done by the Son. But if I didn't, if I got rebellious and said, He can fix it. If I had not let this truth, it's going to get in me. I know that's hard to do, but that's the truth. That's the truth, and that is the truth. No, it's the truth. It doesn't give license to anything. But here's what your word is. You say, but I know people that will hear that, and they won't do anything, and they will better do that. You know what? They're not really abiding there. They're just saying they're abiding there, and they're trying to get away with stuff. You know what? Me saying the truth didn't give them license. They were going to do it anyway. They just latched on to that as a spiritual reason, but they were going to do it anyway. I didn't cause them to leave Christ or leave the truth or da-da-da-da. Because when you're here, if Jesus said, either Jesus is a liar or he's not, he's not. He said, if you abide in me, I will abide in you, and you shall. He said, shall. He didn't say, and if you luck out. He said, you shall bring forth fruit. That's the word. You know what? I just believed it just like it was. So when my linear seemed to mess up, you know, didn't seem to line up with this, I said, well, I don't live in the linear. I'm not of the linear. This isn't where I draw my life from, my existence from, or my relationship with God from. I'm totally, this, my relationship is the same. It never changes, and it never changes. It's consistent, solid, never changes. Now, what is changing? I'm changing from glory to glory. Into what? Into what? The same image. That's what it says in the Bible. The same image. It didn't just say to that image. It says the same image. Well, isn't that a coincidence? No. It's not. It is a consistency of the Word of God. The testimony of Jesus is what the Bible is declaring. And we've not seen Jesus. We've seen us. We didn't realize that it's not just changing into an image, we're changing into the same. Because it's never changed in the heart of the Father. It is the same. For us, the change is that image. But the same refers back to the relationship between the Father and the Son. He could have said, you've been changed into the image of Jesus. But he said, you've been changed into the same. Which says, this bond will never be broken. And if you have a faith bond in there, you have fellowship with the Father through the Son. And what he declares of the Son is true of you. And if you abide in him, then you are being changed here from glory to glory into that same image. But if you don't abide, and you ignore him, you don't identify in Christ, and you all get, you know, and for a while, everybody keeps going off through their lives, moving around, going through their lives. But what you have to do is break this concept of I am in Christ and dwelling there when I'm aware of it. You're hid. You're not. You think you're looking at you. You're not. You are hid. Now, the Bible says that you either are or you're not. Okay? But heaven and earth are going to pass away if this word is. And if you're on earth and you're not on the word, then you're going to pass away. So I think I'll stick with this. I'm hid. You know how I know I'm hid? Because the word says. You don't act like you're hid, brother. You're just using that as a license for sin. You may think that, and it may appear that way. But I got news for you. I'm hid. The word of God says I'm hid. God's word will not fail. It will not pass away. And if everything's passing away around me, I'm going to be pointing right here and saying, I am hid in Christ. Of God am I in Christ. I didn't put myself there. You did it. And you either a liar or you're not. And I don't believe you're a liar. I am in the Son. And it is the same. And my testimony in my mouth is going to be the same because I'm going to begin to speak the same. Let us say speak the same thing. The same. So we want to speak the thing. He didn't say speak the thing. He said speak the same. Do you see the difference though? I mean, huge the difference between one realm and the other. We go, well, if I parrot this just right, how do you say that again? Well, if dead, that'll get you nothing. Except the sore throat. It won't. I mean, if you've ever tried it, it won't. But when you begin to speak the same, know that Jesus Christ is the same. The same is in the beginning with God. And my relationship has not changed. I am in Christ. I am one with my Father through the Son. I am one in Christ. They that are joined to the Lord are one spirit. Well, you don't act like one spirit right now. I have been angry and said, and somebody, yeah, you're the one always mouthing off saying you're one spirit, one with the Lord, you know, they that are joined to the Lord, one spirit. What about this? And I say, I hate this, and this ain't right, and it's going to pass away, but the truth is not going to pass away. And one day I will not be this way, and it won't come out of me like this, and I know that's the case. So you believe what you want to believe, but this is still the truth, and my actions do not change the truth of the Word of God. Pretty soon I was angry out of God, but I'm speaking the word, and I'm just going, man, this, you know what I mean? And I'm preaching to myself, and I'm going, yeah, get this sucker! most of you here never saw that medicine, but she didn't see a lot because in the early days, I was learning the Lord, but she came. Jerry said, I could do stuff, you know, and really, and this stuff would just fly out of me. I just, you know, I would be embarrassed and ashamed because I wanted it to be the Lord. But I believe this, and I remember saying, this will, I remember saying to people, but I said it because I believed it would not move. This will not be here forever. I hate it more than you do, and I'm sorry that you're having to even be around this junk, but this stuff will not be here. You know what? That stuff is not there. It's not there. Not like that. It's not. It is not like it's not there. It's, I have been changed. And I've been changed. But the neat thing is, isn't the change that's going on. That's where we're always looking. Because we're still down here somewhere on the line trying to look and compare. This is what's been the same. And he didn't say at a certain juncture when you conform and you look really a lot like him. No, here's where it's the same, right here. And I'm in him. And that doesn't change to the heart of the Father. That's why I'm trying to take you out of this and put you in the heart of the Father. The Father will not change his attitude towards his Son. It is settled. It is the same. It is consistent. And that's why God did the best thing he could. He put you in Christ. You are in Christ. You are so secure, it's unbelievable. But if you live down here, use this truth as an excuse to be linear, then you don't really have the truth anyway, do you? But if it's not an excuse, this is your reality, and this too shall pass. Whatever I'm dealing with here will pass. Whatever I'm dealing with here will pass. Whatever I'm dealing with here, these things are not, they are not. Because you believe this truth, we're talking about the difference between being concerned and worried. We look and we see stuff wrong. And you're either concerned, or you're worried. If you're worried, you're carrying the load. If there's a concern, the concern is what? I'm concerned because I know that this is not the image of Christ that I believe here. I'm concerned that it's not affect others. I'm concerned this and that. But I'm trusting. You never get to a place with this truth where you just go, well, it just don't matter. You can just take this. Or it doesn't matter to me. I mean, I'm in Christ. It just doesn't matter at all. You understand what I mean? You never get to a place where you have an attitude and you just live whatever you want. If anything in this life that doesn't line up with this is a concern, but it is actually the Holy Spirit's concern. Your job is to not get lax with it and go, well, I can live with this. You can, you probably can, but tough, I'm in Christ. And you've got a real problem. You never harden your heart. You stay soft. You stay tender. And you know what it does? It is so, I love this dichotomy or this paradox, actually, of weakness and strength. It is just a beautiful, beautiful, beautiful thing of almost total strength and at the same time total weakness. It is amazing. All the strength of this reality, the power of this reality, and yet this absolutely, Paul said, when I came to you, I came in demonstration of spirit and in power. But he said, but I was with you in fear and trembling and in much weakness. And so you see him going, I am not able. But then you see the power of God and the life of God and the strength of all this reality. So you never, you know, this gets into the real spirit reality of taking the lower seat. You don't just go, well, walk into a room and go, I'm going to just take the lower seat because Jesus said, I mean, that's probably not a bad idea to do it. But you know your weaknesses. And you know know that if God exalts you, then it's because he's going to exalt his son. Because he don't want to just exalt you, and then you exalt the flesh. He's just not going to have it, he wants to do it. So why would he exalt you? Because he makes sure he comes to just exalt his son. If you exalt his son, the son's going to exalt the father. The father is going to lift up the son. The Holy Spirit's going to lift you up to be able to lift. It's just going to keep going around and around. Everybody's glorifying everybody else, lifting up everybody else, strengthening everybody else, giving everybody else. You don't have to be concerned about you. When you stop the cycle and you start looking within, you're concerned, I got to take care of myself. I got to do this. I got to, oh, I can't do that. I can't. You've got your eyes on here. You've got your eyes on you. Stuck in the world, claiming you believe certain things that you never, never learning, never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. I don't know if that's the truth. Never learning, never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Many of these things are so big that, you know, I don't know what 5 years holds. I don't know if we've got 15 years. I don't know if we've got 20 years. But I know we got right now, today. I know we've got this moment. I mean, I know we've got this moment. We've got the, you know, if the next one kicks off, we've got that. I don't know. So, the time to talk about this, to grasp this, isn't going to be 5 years. You cannot guarantee 5 years. You don't know where you'll be. I know people that say, oh, you know, I'll get that later on. They got married, they got kids, they got all this kind of stuff, and they have to work a job, they've got to keep up with all this stuff. They have no time. They have no strength when they've got the time. And because their life is so full of all this, and they're carrying all these burdens themselves, and they're doing it because they should have filled it up, got the Lord. And then if the Lord added all that, it wouldn't be quite the burden it is. You understand what I'm saying? You know, there's a timing for it. But because they didn't, now they're all beat down. And they can't fulfill what they're supposed to, even if it was the will of God to get married and have kids. But there was a will of God before that. Strong in the Lord and power of his mind. Then you can take on anything that the Lord leads you. Make sense? So, this stuff, or one of your brothers or sisters gives you a hard time, or just have an article published on it.
No, I've got, you know, I look bad in your eyes and I need to, you know.
Hey, man, Paul said, everything about me, I cannot tell you, but I have no crime. This is my identity. You don't know anything, let me share the Lord with you. That's the only identity I want you to know about me. So that, and there's a time when you really get to go through that. Then later on, it gets refined and you do all that kind of stuff. But your identity is you, and you're always trying to keep good relations with everybody because you want to be alive. Then, you know, you're gonna fake some stuff. When you do that long enough, you're gonna become fake. So the best thing to do is let Christ be your identity. Always start, if you start in the beginning, Jesus is the beginning and the end, so you're going to end in the end, aren't you? But if you don't start in the beginning, you can't end in the end because Jesus is the beginning and the end. Make sense? Father, thank you for this time. We just ask that we bless your word. Bring forth reality to this, that you can dwell in the end. And you'll do your part of bringing forth the end of the night.